Welcome back to the third installment in this series on ethical hacking. In the first one, we took a look at what is the job role in general. And then in the second video, we looked at what elements go into the job. What kinds of things do you, if you're an ethical hacker, have to do? What kind of tools and things like that? In this video, we're going to take a look at how you go about getting a job. How you get prepared for this. The kinds of things that go into making you possibly able to be an ethical hacker, like Patrick, who I brought along with me. He does this stuff for a living. So I want to start off, Patrick, asking you, what was your path getting into this? Now, everyone's going to have a little bit different journey, so you don't need to exactly map his, but learn from what his experience was. So how did you get into this field? What was your path?
Sure. Well, I'll skip over the first couple of years, so maybe they're not quite so relevant, but I started my sort of IT career when I was in college working basically help desk type of work, and that was really good because it gave me a good background in working with computers on day-to-day and also working with customers. Then I joined.
And I'm sure that also showed you how things can break. You know, people are calling you in the help desk. Hey, I can't get into my system. And then maybe it's a hacking issue or maybe it's not. But you got exposed to both of those.
It also gave me an opportunity to play around with how do I optimize this? Can I improve it? Can I make it better than the way it was designed to be initially? And so it gives you a good background in every aspect.
Sure.
But from there, I decided to join the military. So I spent the next about 6 years in the Marine Corps.
Thank you for your service.
I appreciate that. And it was maybe not quite so related work, but I had the opportunity to maybe spend some time with like DOD information assurance folks and get some background. So it was some OJT, but basically that was a little bit of a break in my overall IT career.
Sure. And there's a lot of carryover from the mindset of military is obviously about offense and defense, and we're in the same kind of battle, just analogously, when we're talking about IT. So I'm sure some of the lessons learned in the battlefield and those kind of areas can also apply here.
Absolutely. And in fact, a lot of the terminology we've used over these past couple of videos are things that have been derived from the military. For whatever reason, cybersecurity loves to pull their terminology and concepts from military type things.
Yeah. So what did you do after that?
So as I was getting ready to leave the military, I started working on some certifications. I was able to use my GI Bill to go take a lot of training, which was awesome. But I got my first real InfoSec job as a security analyst.
Okay, gotcha. And what was involved in that?
So I like to tell people this was my, I'm going to say really my starting, because it was very generic. It was a jack of all trades. So we did everything from really generic type security assessments. So think vulnerability scanning and analysis, all the way up to IT audit and risk assessment.
Okay, gotcha. And then from there, you end up here.
That's right. Well, there was one more step, I guess. You could think of it as a continuing specialization. So as a security analyst, one of the things I had an opportunity to do was penetration testing. And so my next job was focused purely on penetration testing.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So that's an aspect of ethical hacking. And then?
Definitely. So after I had spent maybe 7 years doing penetration testing, I had an opportunity to move over to red teaming, which is, again, maybe just a further specialization in the overall field.
Yeah. So, in fact, we talked about in the other two videos a triangle where it began with vulnerability testing, pen testing, and then red teaming. And so now you're doing adversarial simulations and things of that sort. Okay, Patrick, so that was your path, but what was your preparation? What kinds of things did you have to do in order to get to this point in the first place? Let's start off talking about sort of the mindset, the aptitudes, and things like that. What do you think are important about those that you'd be looking for in an ethical hacker?
Certainly. And you can imagine that we have people with lots of different types of aptitudes and backgrounds. But overall, what I look for is someone who has that inquisitive sort of mindset. Somebody who maybe as a child was the type of person to take a toy apart and maybe even put it together in a different way so it achieves some different objective.
Yeah, that was me as a kid for sure. Everything I got, I wanted to know how it worked, and I'm still that way. I want to know how things work. And I think if you have that kind of curiosity, that's going to be an important start. It's not sufficient, but it's a really good place to start.
I agree. And you tend to find that people who have that mindset are very passionate about this type of work. It tends to drive them to you know, have to take the thing apart. I have to know. And they'll keep going until they figure it out.
Yeah, and I think also the mindset, again, I made some facetious comments about just joyriding and like this thing is a big video game. There is a lot of fun in this, but there's also a lot of work in this. And if someone just thinks this is going to be like playing video games, they're going to be really sorely disappointed. So the mindset also has to involve having some discipline, knowing where the limits are, pushing those limits, but knowing where to stay on the side of those, ethics, a lot of those kinds of things, being responsible and so forth. That's the reason they're paying you. So I think that's going to be critical here as well.
Definitely. And, you know, we think about mindset. We have to think about we're also on a team. So we have people who rely on us. Like you said, we have to have a deliverable. We're giving that to a client. That's what they're going to pay us for. We also have to think, you know, cybersecurity is changing, is maturing and growing. And I once had a friend tell me that probably one of the most fun things a human can do is exploit their a system. So the first time you actually accomplish that is very satisfying. But that's getting harder. You know, computers are getting harder to break into. And so you have to mature with it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I like that idea of teamwork, because the image is often of a hacker of any sort as this lone wolf just off doing their own thing. You know, it's somebody where they've got a job where, you close the door, you slide pizzas under the door, and then they give you code out the other end or reports or whatever. That's not really how it works so much in the real world. We've got to work as a team in order to accomplish this stuff.
You can peg me in pizzas, but I suggest it's probably not the best approach.
I would agree. So how about in terms of some of the other preparations? Do I need a college degree in order to do this?
Not necessarily. What we really look for when we're finding our someone to hire or bring onto the team is, do they have the true capability? Can they, you know, not just talk the talk, can they walk the walk? Can they show us that they can do the things that we need them to be able to do? Now, often we find that a degree does help. It's a very helpful sort of thing. My degree is in business.
Yeah.
And I will tell you that, especially in the first 5-10 years of my career, when I'd run into really strong computer science guys, I was very jealous because they were so far ahead of me on the power curve.
So it can certainly, if you have this, it can advantage you toward it. So for me, I did my degree in computer science. So I felt like I was, you know, well-trained in a wide variety of things. But again, the point is there's not one path. There's not one single answer. You were able to go out and get some more hands-on skills earlier in your career that were able to supplement that and make it so that you could do that. But I'm an adjunct professor, so I'm always going to say, yeah, a degree is important because I believe in that. That's what I'm spending my time on. But that said, it's not for everyone. Some people do boot camps. What's your experience with that? Do you think that qualifies someone?
Not necessarily. I think it goes back to the aptitude and mindset, which is people who are very passionate and drawn to this type of work, the people who like to take things apart, they can use boot camps to teach them core skills that they can use to make them very effective. But it's not just a supplement. It's not a checkbox that will get you a job necessarily.
Yeah. So again, each one of these things, I think you have to look at them in total. They're all adding up. So a boot camp could be a way, for instance, to enhance your degree that you've already done. Or you could do it the other way around, where you start off with a boot camp and you get some of the basics, you get an entry-level job, then you want to move up, you want to get past the glass ceiling that might be blocking you, and the degree helps you do that. So you could do this in a number of different orders. Another thing that I think hiring organizations are looking for are certifications. So what ones of those are particularly important, do you think, in this space?
Sure. And, you know, one thing I'll mention on the certifications is it's a great way to show an employer that you do have some skill, because it's basically showing that you took a test and verified that you're capable of something. And certainly certain certifications are going to be more useful earlier in your career versus maybe later on. But maybe some really well-known ones I would start off with would be something like Network Plus.
Yeah. Network Plus is a good one that's well known. And like you said, the point of these certs would be to demonstrate to an employer who doesn't have time to ask you all the things and find out what all you've done. But obviously a degree is one way of providing a credential for that. This is another. What are some of the others that relate here?
Another good one is CCNA. So if you're familiar with, you know, Cisco networking, and just like Network Plus, I think this is a really cool one because it's not just saying, hey, I want to go learn how to hack. It's saying, hey, I'm interested in understanding how this technology works at its core level, and I'm actually capable of going and implementing it.
Yeah. What I've heard a lot of people in this space have is a certified ethical hacker certification as well.
Yeah. CEH is a well-known one that, you know, it gives you a good shared knowledge base and language so that you can show, hey, I actually understand what these tools are, how they work, and maybe how not to maybe break a system by using them.
Yeah, sure. And how about this one? OCSP.
OSCP.
OSCP. Yes.
Yeah, that's a great one. This is the one that I like because it's so hands-on and it really focuses on, can you actually perform these skills in a live environment? You actually need to be, you know, to be able to demonstrate that you really understand these things at a fundamental level.
And it's also testing whether you're dyslexic or not in our case, so there's that. And then something else would be, we've talked about Network Plus, Security Plus. There's a lot of people that can't get this ultimate cert in cybersecurity, the CISSP, which is kind of considered the gold standard of certificates, but they're not really ready for that yet in terms of knowledge or experience, and there is a five-year requirement for experience, but this cert can be one that's an entry level that leads you then to the CISSP.
Definitely, and the two things I would say about these is they're really great in that they give you all the terminology and concepts that you need to sort of maybe move to the next step. So they give you the foundation you need, because one of the things that you may run into in interviews is, hey, do you understand this concept or this terminology? And if you've never heard it before, you're going to be at a loss.
Yeah, exactly. And it's interesting how some of these tend to be, you know, more hands-on, and some of them tend to be more theoretical and conceptual. But it's not that one is enough. You need to really understand both if you're really going to succeed in this field.
That's right. You can't write the report if you don't understand the words.
Okay, Patrick, you've reached the highest level in your field in this area of adversarial simulation and ethical hacking. So what kind of advice, if you were able to go back into a time machine and talk to your younger self, what would you tell yourself?
One of the key things that I would always try to you know, impart to anybody, particularly my younger self, is always keep an eye on what you need to know yet next, because the field is changing quickly and it's hard to keep up sometimes. I'm sure you've probably talked a lot about AI over the past year or two. You know, knowing what's coming around the corner is a really key element to staying afloat in this industry.
Yeah, I think so. You've got to stay curious. You've got to keep learning. If you're comfortable, well, then you're going to be uncomfortable very soon. And AI is a really good example of that. When you see those new technologies coming along, don't say, I'm not interested in that. When you see that light, you want to run to the light, because guess what? The bad guys are going to be using this to try to break in. If I'm going to defend against that, I need to understand it at least as well as they do, if not better. Anything else you would tell your former self?
Yeah, never be the smartest person in the room. I like to surround myself with people who are more knowledgeable than me, so I can learn from them and rely on them and make sure that we're, you know, moving forward together.
Yeah, that goes to that element of teaming as well. And I think what is critically important is being a lifelong learner. You don't ever want to say, I'm comfortable with this. Again, I'm looking for flexibility. I'm looking for curiosity. I'm looking for someone who enjoys learning. If you don't enjoy learning, you're in the wrong field with cybersecurity, because this field is always moving. But to me, that's what makes it really fun.
I agree.
Yeah. So there's a little bit of advice. And, you know, maybe I would tell myself to not wear that shirt that I used to have, maybe get rid of that, because that's not going to hold up well. But anyway, there's a little bit. One more question for you, Patrick, though. I just want to know, can you get me a job?
Well, unfortunately, Jeff, I am not in charge of the hiring. I'm not involved in hiring, so I can't actually help you out. However, I would suggest you keep your eyes open, look at places like LinkedIn, or if you want to come work at IBM, check out ibm.com/jobs.
Yeah, this is where we post all of the job postings at this company, but there's a lot of jobs out there. So don't just ask a stranger or someone that you don't know for that. Build your credentials and start working with people. Do internships, do things like that that put you in a place where you now know the people. You need to build a network of people and people that actually know you and have observed your work. They're the ones who can serve as references for you. So there's a lot of jobs happening out here and a lot of opportunity in this space. The one thing the bad guys do is they never sleep, it seems. So they're always creating new opportunities for folks like us. And that's quite a gift, I guess we should look at it as one way. So in this series, I hope you've enjoyed it. We've looked at the role, we've looked at the job overall, and some of the career advice that you can follow in order to become an ethical hacker.